Dear fellows, dear guests, I'm delighted to contribute to the 2015-16 series of the Society with a lecture on the archaeology of Via Egnatia. I'm Eurydice Georganteli, a Marie Curie Senior Research Fellow, and my work in the past 2 years is on a very significant European cultural route, which is very much understudied. Today, we are going to explore the rediscovery of this route by some early modern pioneers who ventured off the beaten track and recorded antiquities and remarked on the connection between people and monuments. But first things first, the story of the Egnatian route began in the 4th century BC when King Philip II of Macedon embarked on an ambitious project to unite independent Greek city-states under his name and to conquer new and important north lands northeast and west of the heartland of his kingdom. The Vasiliki Odos, the royal route, was a necessary route to lead his expansionary policy. The road extended from roughly the area of Philippi in eastern Macedonia to Ohrid, which is the modern-day Republic of Macedonia. The road united important centers of mineral and land resources that carried huge economic and military potential. On the site of Crinides, on the foot of Mount Pangaeon, Philip founded Philippi, a city which became synonymous with silver and golden mines that fueled his military campaigns. Neapolis, and this is one of his status, which was made possible because of the golden mines of Pangaeon. Neapolis, a Thracian colony and member of the Delian League, was taken over by Philip in 350 BC and was used as the harbor of the city of Philippi. In 42 BC, Neapolis became the base of the navy of the Republican leaders Brutus and Cassius, and in 49 AD, it was the first city in Europe visited by St. Paul. Amphipolis, a prosperous Athenian colony on the Strymon estuary, contested very often by Athens and Sparta, was taken over by Philip in 357 BC and was to become the power base for his navy. Here you can see the latest archaeological discovery in Amphipolis, which also became very controversial in Greece. This is a major burial. We don't know who commissioned this tomb. Oop.
That's okay. Oh dear. The power cord has come out. So.
But while Renee is trying to fix it, but this is the most important and expensive tomb created for a personality, someone probably from the royal court or from the entourage of Alexander. Don't worry. So further to the west, we're going to see it eventually, Thessaloniki on the plain of the Thermaic Gulf. Cassander, son-in-law of Philip II, founded Thessaloniki, which was to become one of the most important Mediterranean harbors. And further to the west, we have Pella, which was a seat of government and birthplace of Philip. So Philip was, of course, very much interested in connecting Pella with the east and west. So here is Amphipoli, with a melee of different architectural styles, and you can see the Sphinx, you can see the chorus guarding the tomb and the identity of a person we don't know who he is or she is. In Thessaloniki, recent archaeological discoveries have made life for subsequent Greek governments a nightmare because 5 meters below the modern Egnatia Odos. My fellow archaeologists have uncovered this amazing hub of commercial activity from the Roman all the way to the Middle Byzantine period. In Pella, the birthplace of Philip, this stunning mosaic floor records the life and habits and pastimes of the Macedonian court. And further to the west, Edessa, a city not often visited, preserves these amazing fortifications, the agora, and its life stretches from the Hellenistic all the way to the Ottoman period. Now, Edessa controlled the area of Upper Macedonia, and through the royal route, it led to Heraclea Lingistis, now at the Republic in the Republic of Macedonia. And here, 2 kilometers south of modern-day Bitola, a visitor, if you're up to this, can come across this incredible site. Next to a cemetery, next to a dumping place, you come across a city with an amphitheater, lots of administrative buildings, basilicas, and the most stunning mosaics in the Balkans. And further to the west, we come across the Hellenistic and Roman city of Ohrid, of Lichnidos, and here it's part of the amphitheater overlooking the lake. This was the border of the Macedonian kingdom. This was the end of the royal route. What happens next is that in the first century BC, the Romans expanded on what Philip had created. And this was a major feat of civil engineering. So the Via Egnatia connected Dyrrhachium on the Adriatic Sea all the way to Thessaloniki, all the way to Philippi, then Kypsela, and then Byzantium and Constantinople. The milestone of Egnatia preserved, this one in the Archaeological Museum of Thessaloniki, preserves even the name of the person who commissioned the work or who was responsible for the construction of Egnatia. In the first century AD, Egnatia becomes intertwined with the travels of St. Paul, and from 330 AD, with the political and cultural trajectory of Byzantium. Today, the Via Egnatia and its connecting routes are being shared by Albania, Bulgaria, Serbia, Greece, the Republic of Macedonia, and Turkey, which makes things very complicated for the preservation of cultural heritage. Three sites along Egnatia, Thessaloniki, Pella, Vergina and Ohrid are UNESCO sites, and Philippi has just entered UNESCO's provisional list. The name of the ancient route resurfaced in 1994, thanks to the construction of the Egnatia Odos, another mammoth construction project, which aimed to connect the Ionian Sea with the Evros River, that is the Greek-Turkish border. The construction of this route has inevitably prompted rescue excavations that have resulted in very important new finds, but has failed to address issues regarding preservation of heritage and unification of the archaeological sites. This is a challenge my project tries to address, providing the first study of the route in its entirety and using this study as a platform for regional collaboration so that players in the Balkans can put forward a credible portfolio for the route's accreditation as a European cultural route. I just wanted to go backward to explain what I mean by a cultural route. You can see here that ICOMOM's definition of a cultural route is a land, water, mixed or other type of route which has its own specific and historic dynamics and functionality. In contrast to the tourist routes, cultural routes are neither invented nor designed. And the Via Egnatia meets all these criteria. This is one of Europe's oldest arteries, covers a distance of 696 miles, and links Constantinople, Istanbul, in the Eastern Balkans to Dyrrhachium, Durres on the Adriatic Sea. the connection the road has been providing over time and space to communities, ideas, languages, and religious practices have resulted in a wealth of tangible and intangible heritage. Today, we are exploring aspects of this heritage with the help of a group of pioneers who, from the mid-15th all the way to the 18th century, chose to venture in defiance of often impossible travel logistics in order to observe, record, and decipher Egnatia's archaeology. In 1430, 23 years before the fall of Constantinople to the Ottomans, Cyriacus of Ancona traveled along parts of the route by then unsafe and contested by Turks, Byzantines, and Serbs, and he recorded antiquities and inscriptions. In 1461, the Venetian Giovanni Maria Angiolello followed the stretch of Egnatia from Thessaloniki to Cilimbria as prisoner of war. In the 16th century, Lorenzo Bernardo appears to have traveled along the entire course of Egnatia. And later, Pierre Bellon, a naturalist and antiquarian, describes the section of the road between Thessaloniki and the Evros River. In the 17th century, Father de Dreux, the chaplain of the French ambassador in Constantinople, covered parts of the route, and in 1704, Paul Lucas, also a naturalist and antiquarian, managed to travel along the eastern part of the road. In their exploration and rediscovery of Egnatia, our travelers came across an inhabited space where multiple layers of habitation, destruction, spoliation, reuse, and reconfiguration of space and building material could be found in just one spot. Of course, this was not a phenomenon pertinent for the 15th, 16th, 17th, and 18th century. Byzantines, Serbs, Bulgarians, they lived among ruins and were able to understand what was the heritage of the area. The problem is that although Egnatia's Hellenistic, Roman, and Byzantine legacy inform the everyday life of medieval people there, that legacy was rarely graced with a reference in official Byzantine, Western, or Eastern medieval sources. So the writings related to the life and travels of Cyriacus of Ancona, humanist, antiquarian, merchant, and occasional spy, are the first to break that rule, offering us priceless insight into Egnatia's fast-disappearing antique and medieval landscape. So, let me start with Cyriacus. In 1430, Cyriacus of Ancona set out on a journey to the Levant, armed with his appreciation for antiquity, his keen eye for observation, and loaded with lots of ancient Greek and Roman literary works he carried with him and he purchased along the way. The landscape of Egnatia were very, very difficult to navigate. Throughout his travels, he recorded activities and conveyed his view on the connection or disconnection between Egnatia's inhabitants and their heritage. Purchases he was making, for instance, from an Orthodox monk on the island of Rhodes, of three recently excavated antiquities, illustrate the profusion of Greco-Roman works of art, effectively turning up in people's backyards and being used in this case as a source of income. Other purchases, such as the one Cyriacus made of a number of Greek manuscripts plundered by the Turks from Salonika, document a pivotal moment in the story of Egnatia, when Byzantine heritage became itself part of Egnatia's antiquities. These most recent antiquities, dispersible as spoils of war and collectible for their value, in this case literary value, offered their new owner multiple associations with Christendom's fabled Eastern Roman Empire and its classical tradition. Cyriacus comments on the monuments and sites of Philippi, Thessaloniki, and Enos, to mention a few, further conveyed the importance he placed on interacting with the physical remains of antiquity rather than reading about them in books, a quality that has justifiably associated him with the birth of archaeology. In Philippi, Cyriaco encountered an archaeological site strewn with fine monuments, a theater, inscriptions, tombs of illustrious men, and the remains of once mighty, the mighty fortification. But he was particularly drawn to an imposing monolithic structure outside the eastern city walls. And this is the structure. And we had to circle the modern village of Crinides last summer, and I have excavated in Philippi for 5 years, so shame on me. But this is just a great example of how we don't use great signage to point to people, to these monuments. So this first century monument of some 4 meters high once marked the stretch of Via Egnatia between Neapolis and Philippi and can still be seen 2 kilometers from the archaeological site. The name of the location, known among the locals with a Turkish name, Dikilitas, and the Greek name is Orthopetra, which means upright stone, obviously refers to the imposing structure. 2 of the 4 sides of the monument bear an inscription partly surviving that details the career of a certain Caius Vibius Quartus from the 5th Legion of Macedonia and commander of the 3rd Regiment of Cyrenaica in the service of Emperor Augustus. As the end of the inscription has been destroyed, there is no indication as to whether a grave lies underneath or whether it was something erected in honor of this guy. He was clearly a megalomaniac, or the city was trying to impress him. Either way, the size of the structure and related expenditure encapsulates the importance and visibility of the Roman military in the civic life of first century Philippi. At the time of Cyriaco's visit, the Greek-speaking population referred to it as the manger of Alexander's horse Bucephalus, and revered this stone for its association with the life of Alexander. As in the case of other sites along Egnatia, the story behind Caius Vibius' monument was retold by generations of locals to express the pre-Roman face of Philippi. The name manger of Alexander's horse, used in this case, says a lot about the way its scholars process the history of the landscape they inhabited and evaluate its multiple phases of human activity. In the second half of the 19th century, the French archaeologist Léon Heuzet and Honoré Domet recorded Caius Vibius' monument, and this is a drawing from their book, and this monument was still standing now next to an Ottoman inn for travelers. They came, these guys, face to face with the locals' persisting reverence of what effectively had become a sacred landscape, linked in all probability to the memory of Alexander. And they noted, a superstition attaches to the white powder that is obtained by scratching the marble of Dikilitas. So they were scratching it. The locals think that the marble has the ability to give milk to nursing mothers. It has been devoured by the knives of villages. Over half of the inscription has been destroyed in this way. Cyriaco's second exploration took him in the eastern part of Egnatia. And it's amazing that he couldn't actually travel overland, but he was hopping from place to place by sailing. So it shows that the road was very, very dangerous by that time. From Cylimbria, he managed to go to Heraclea Perinthos, aboard a fishing boat. And there, he wandered and looked at the town's fortifications, most of them in a state of collapse. He identified the remains of the ancient walls and of numerous relatively modern defensive walls and towers, and he understood that the Byzantine Emperor Heraclius was behind this construction. Scattered stones, some of them in second use as part of the Byzantine walls and churches, charted the historical and cultural trajectory of Perinthos, especially the period following the extension of Via Egnatia by Emperor Trajan and the subsequent rise in importance of urban centers along the stretch of the route Neapolis, that is Kavala, to Constantinople. Inscriptions mentioning Greeks and Latins, pagans and Christians, cities and areas stretching from North Africa, Asia Minor, and Lesbos to Pannonia, spoke to Cyriaco of a long-gone cosmopolitan community. Melancholy and a sense of loss for the once splendid city sum up Cyriaco's feeling for the places and communities along Egnatia on the eve of the Ottoman conquest. Perinthos' beautiful ruins in a way stand for the ruins of every city he came across. All those places were experiencing increased disconnection caused by the breakdown of communications and great uncertainty in the face of the Ottoman advance. Cyriaco's apprehension about what might become of those ancient and glorious places mirrors contemporary disquiet in Western Europe for what people perceived as the impending end of times. And Cyriaco channels that anxiety in a high symbolic gesture he made to his good friend and fellow spy, Raffaele Castiglione. So what he does, he gives a coin to Raffaele, and this coin comes from his private collection. The coin I made it up, that is, this is a coin of Vespasian. To give you an idea how it might have looked like. So we don't know whether Cyriaco found it, purchased it, or he just carried. I think he must have found close to Perinthos. And Vespasian, of course, is an emperor who holds a very special place in Christian rhetoric and the story of the early church. What is interesting is that Cyriaco creates this inflated and highly favorable picture about Vespasian, trying to lure Raffaele Castiglione and saying by looking at the ancient coin, he really hoped that his friend would reverence and recall again and again, undoubtedly, the mortal danger not only Byzantium but also Western Christendom was facing as a whole. Following Egnatia's fall to the Ottomans, libraries and works of art made their journey to the West. Their displacement was to become Western Europe's gain, familiarizing the 16th century scholarly communities in France, in Italy, and Germany with a wealth of ancient and Byzantine culture, and allowing for a more nuanced understanding of Byzantium now as a past empire and focus itself of antiquarian interest. Here you can see the leitmotif, Macedonia. This is, let's say, at the center of the Egnatia, the country that once rules the world, is unfortunately subject to the vile Turks, to whom it has become tributary and subservient. And this is an idealized, improbable picture of a landscape of Macedonia. And in this atmosphere, we have two very interesting personalities. We have André Thévé, who writes the Cosmographie du Levant, and we have Les Singularités, a book by Pierre Bellon. Both were composed in the creative atmosphere of rediscovery of the East literary traditions. Yet the interest of those early modern travelers in ancient and Byzantine monuments and sites, and their distaste for the Ottomans, came hand in hand with feelings of mistrust, religious prejudice, and ambivalence as to what Byzantium represented. Those travelers, mostly Frenchmen, their presence was linked to their country's political and cultural agenda in the East. There were favorable conditions created by the capitulations France had signed and renewed with the Ottoman Porte. And if André Thévé was making highly wildly and surprising comments about the sites he never visited, Montaigne comments about our guy, Pierre Bellon, that he was a true topographer. His sense experience evident in the meticulous description of routes he took, fauna and flora he saw and skillfully drew in his travel journals, and the towns and people he encountered. Among his itineraries, the eastern section of Egnatia, from Thessaloniki to Constantinople, is one of the most memorable ones. For the wealth of information it offers on travel logistics, land resources, archaeology, and the built environment. What becomes apparent is that the past informs every single page of Pierre Bellon's work, helping him to understand the landscapes he encountered. This past was dominated by antique Greece and Rome and illustrated by ancient historians, poets, doctors, and philosophers to whom Bellon makes a regular reference with the occasional sleeps. The ancient kings of Macedon, and in particular Alexander the Great and Philip II, provide an overarching platform for his narrative and are credited for most of the important works along Egnatia. It doesn't matter if these works were executed by the Byzantines or the Serbs or the Bulgarians, everything has to do with Philip and Alexander. So what about Balkans Byzantine, or otherwise referred to as Christian past? This appears elusive and blurring, inhabiting the fringes of Bellon's narrative and open to misattributions. But what he gets right is, of course, the things about the mineral resources of Egnatia. And if you want to write a book about the mines and mints along the Egnatian route, it's very important that you read Pierre Bellon, who makes a very detailed account of what is found in Thassos of the Egnatia and Mount Pangaeon. Three successive editions of his book in just 3 years demonstrate its immense popularity. The book was dedicated to Cardinal François de Tournon from the Abbey of Saint-Germain in Paris, patron of scholars. And this is the audience Bellon wanted to impress. And you can see in this edition, the Paris edition, he chooses not to have this kind of proemion in Latin, but in Greek. And it's a very wonderful prose. And it looks like the proemion of Ulysses Ithaca. And this description gives way to the another edition, to an elaborate sonnet in French by Aubert, which was originally written for TV and tweaked to suit Bellon's profile. I prefer this one because it's so funny and says a lot about Bellon. In the course of the 17th century, a new wave of Western travelers ventured along Egnatia. Their journeys were made possible thanks to effort by France to renegotiate capitulations with the Ottoman Porte in the hope to regain some of its economic power, which has seriously been compromised by the opening of new trade routes and the flooding of silver from Mexico and Bolivia to the coffers of the Spanish crown. In the context of those early modern French-Ottoman encounters, travelers such as Father Robert de Dreux, a monk of the Abbey of Saint-Jacques in Paris, visited part of Egnatia as members of French embassies. Others, such as Delacroix and Paul Lucas, ventured into Ottoman territories to collect works of art for the King of France, precisely because these new favorable conditions were in place. From those early modern encounters, travel narratives became in France a very popular literary genre, resulting in the publication by 1690 of some 1,300 titles. Those narratives, called interchangeably récits and relations de voyage, truly changed literary taste, eclipsing even novels in popularity. Travel accounts of the East familiarized a large body of readership with distant lands increasingly within Western Europe's reach, and in the context of diplomacy, commerce, religious missionaries, antiquarian interest, aesthetics, and quest for learning. But exactly where did the Orient start in European perception, and what kind of travel accounts did the récits and relations de voyage constitute? There has been, I'm sure you know most of it, a large body of literature debating the idea of the Orient, the Oriental other, and Orientalism as a trend. But for the purpose of this lecture, I would like just to borrow 17th century French voices that describe the Orient. The term could mean vast expanses of land. Egnatia is one of them, in one of the four corners of the world, where the sun rises, and groups of people inhabiting those lands, united by geography, ethnicity, religion, and cultural behaviors, markedly different from those in Western Europe. The Orient could also refer to the Levant, a geographical term defined as the countries and places east of France, from Smyrna to Aleppo and the Eastern Mediterranean, otherwise known as La Mer de Levant. The ancient Via Egnatia, admired by those 17th century travelers as the great route that people used in the past when traveling from Rome to Constantinople, was part of an Oriental landscape, replete with excitement, peppered with a certain frisson of potential danger, and there were plenty of danger, and with promises for important observations and discoveries relevant to botany, zoology, and archaeology. In this landscape, the past served as a looking glass through which the Ottoman-dominated Balkans scored a most unfavorable reflection. Cultural norms and adjectives such as the totally bastardized people of Greece, unworthy inhabitants of an ancient and glorious country, now in ruins. I think this reminds me, you know, 21st century rhetoric, right? Which they displayed ignorance became the subject of early sociocultural anthropological observations. Some travelers linked the destruction and absence of books and manuscripts in Greece to what they described as ignorance and militant hostility displayed by high Orthodox Church officials and patriarchs to any non-theological literature. That approach, which conveniently ignored Byzantium's role in the transmission of classical tradition and knowledge through the preservation and copy of ancient manuscripts, legitimized, if not encouraged, the collection of antiquities for Western European cabinet de curiosité and collections. Greece's antiquities had to be saved from their ignorant and unworthy custodians, be it Christians or Muslims. And the Western traveler's approach to the Muslim population along Egnatia is equally illuminating of the often conflicting political agendas of early modern Europe vis-à-vis the Ottoman Empire. The 1571 Battle of Lepanto, the 1683 Battle of Vienna, were reminders of just how close for comfort the Islamic Orient was at Western Europe's doorstep. That Orient was both menacing and alluring. Menace was related to the vast religious gap, but that same attribute rendered the Ottomans rather alluring. Those inhabitants represented the exotic other, vastly different and difficult to understand. One of the travelers who was able to comment on this relation between the Ottomans and their landscape is, of course, the Reverend Robert de Dreux. He had the chance to immerse himself during his travel in a world as far removed from Paris as possible. From Constantinople to Smyrna and from Edirne to Thessaloniki, Larissa, and Athens, the monuments, sites, and their inhabitants he encountered are vignettes of archaeological interest. His discoveries along Via Egnatia started shortly after leaving Constantinople's gate. And after crossing the Evros or Merit River, Robert de Dreux and his companions arrived at Vira, on the western bank of the Evros River. If you visit Vira these days, you will see this is a hamlet at the Greek-Turkish border, completely forgotten by the Greek administration. But it preserves one of the most stunning examples of Byzantine architecture and interior decoration. Vira started as a monastery founded by the black sheep of the imperial family, Isagios Komnenos. And eventually he created a monastery and then a fortress, and from there a small town. Now, what you see in 2014 during our visit is also what Robert de Dreux saw in the 17th century, in the middle of the 17th century. The landscape is completely unchanged. So he couldn't sleep during his stay, so he wandered around, and he observed the remains of what he describes as ancient fortifications and the pretty mosque. Of course, the pretty mosque is no other than the Catholicon of the Virgin Kosmosotira. What is exciting is that the mosque's imam became de Dreux's eager guide. He wanted to point to de Dreux the tombs with epitaphs that reflected the former identity of the place as a church. And de Dreux was able to take in the remains of the Byzantine fortifications and the expansive views over the vast Evros Valley. He also saw the converted religious space and tombstones, all from a distant past. They all evoked a 17th century landscape, both changed and timeless. So the 17th century imam features in the Récit of Dédreux as the new guardian of a sacred landscape, where memories of Byzantium were preserved in the funerary inscriptions and the shape of the church and the mosque, even if the splendid frescoes of its interior lay beneath layers of whitewash. Memories of Byzantium and this permissive climate of religious tolerance, I'll go to this one, yes, permeate also the travel accounts by Evliya Çelebi. This is our Ottoman 17th century traveler, administrator, and tireless storyteller, who crisscrossed the Balkans on official business always. Çelebi's encounter with Egnatia's heritage is quite different from Dédreux's viewpoint, filtered through the Ottoman perspectives, spiced with outrageous stories about Alexander, Philip, and prophets, and the prophet Mohammed. But despite his often fanciful historical associations, Çelebi is not a fool. And even though he doesn't get everything right, his reading of inscriptions and architectural remains are of great value. From his account, I would like to share with you his view of Ohrid, the city called the Jerusalem of the Balkans because of the sheer number of its churches, was at the time of Çelebi's visit a very well-established independent sanjak in the administrative unit of Rumelia. Its income was something like 235,000 silver coins, an astounding sum that reflects the breadth of economic activities that took place in the city and the importance of Lake Ohrid as a major revenue source. So Çelebi describes the Acropolis as a pentagonal fortress, correct, solidly built, correct. Of course, he exaggerates about the height of the citadel. He says it's something like 30 meters high. This is not true. But exaggeration aside, Ohrid Acropolis remains, especially after its restoration in 2003, an imposing monument of civil engineering, with layers from the type of Philip, of the Romans, of Byzantium, and of the Bulgarian Tsar Samuel. Excavations led by the Institute and Museum in Ohrid in 2004 uncovered the remains of what is believed to be the first fortification built by Philip II. Now, the churches. We have many, many churches in Ohrid, and several of them were at the time of Çelebi's visit in Christian hands. But the largest and most important one, the Cathedral of St. Sophia, was not. So what happened is that this church became a congregational mosque, and it was a political movement. They didn't need the space, but they wanted to make a point to the inhabitants. So he mentions that this church, the congregational mosque, was bigger and more important than the ones in Thessaloniki, Trebizond, and even the church of St. Sergius and Bacchus in Constantinople. But there was a problem. This congregational mosque was stuck in a Christian neighborhood. So there were no people coming for the Friday prayers, and a handful of guards performed the prayers as the sole worshippers and guardians of the mosque. So the most touching indication of the affection and devotion of the Christian population recorded by Çelebi was their effort to pay secreted visits to their former church, and now a forbidden and crumbling Muslim prayer hall, by bribing the Muslim doorkeepers. This leitmotif of religious accommodation and tolerance along Egnatia's landscapes comes again and again also in the 18th century travel accounts. What also becomes obvious in those later accounts are the systematic efforts by Western European agents to collect and ship large numbers of works of art away from Ottoman Egnatia to Western Europe. And with this, I come to our last traveler, that is Paul Lucas. In his proemium of his 1712 book, Paul Lucas makes an effort to say that I dedicate this book to the King of France, and I want to write about the priceless antiquities I have collected for you, my king, in order to contextualize these purchases. Those antiquities, coins, reliefs, and manuscripts, were by 1712 part of the Bibliothèque du Roi and its cabinet, renamed in 1795 the Bibliothèque Nationale de France and the Cabinet de Médailles et des Antiquités, that both Dr. Burnett and myself have visited lots of times. Paul Lucas' exploration of Egnatia's antiquities began in the summer when he left Constantinople and covers the section of the route between Philippi and Thessaloniki. When he approached the city of Drama, his trained eye recognized the splendor and size of the ancient sites through the many architectural remains. He refers to the castle. To the castle and the inscriptions, and here you can see the transcription of some of Drama's inscriptions. But also, he describes an encounter, he had a very peculiar one, with a very difficult fellow. So he comes across a superstitious, what he calls a superstitious and ignorant Turk, who had barricaded himself in a tower. I mean, the tower was his residence. And this was an old Roman and Byzantine tower. The Turk harbored the hope that the tower contained an ancient treasure and that the keys to the treasure were the inscriptions he could not read. Needless to say, he refused Lucas access to the building for fear that Lucas could decipher the inscription and discover the treasure. Despite all the grief that very unwelcoming fellow gave to Lucas, the Frenchman had the chance to buy ancient coins from the locals and admire structures that he describes in his book as an amphitheater, gymnasium, and basins. And if you visit now the city of Drama, you will see that not very much has remained. We have the remains of some Byzantine fortifications, and everything is a muddle. So these very early modern accounts allow us to understand there is more than what we encounter now in the 21st century. Lucas' take on Drama also offered glimpses of the complex relation between an Ottoman townscape, its people, and its ruins. Muslims and Christians often inhabited spaces whose use and building material would go back hundreds, if not thousands, of years. They regularly came across pieces from a distant past, such as inscriptions they could not read or comprehend, and portable antiquities they could sell to passing collectors and antiquarians. Illiteracy meant that inscriptions were revered for their undecipherable messages and seized the collective imagination about ancient treasures and the elusive, in the case of Drama, philosopher's stone. Despite the rather muddled sense of the past, those same people were able to alert Lucas that he was not far away from the remains of the ancient city of Philippi. When he arrives in Thessaloniki, the picture is very different. People not only know their monuments, but also know their monuments with their Christian names, despite the fact that many of them were by then converted into mosques. Among the stunning examples of Byzantine architecture Lucas admired, I would like to focus on Rotunda. So, Lucas, when he talks about Rotunda, talks of an almost spiritual experience he had in a building he deems equal in splendor to Roman Pantheon. And of course, this is a Roman structure which was converted into a Christian place of worship. And then in the Ottoman period, it was converted into a mosque. His experience in Rotunda was facilitated by the presence of a steep staircase sculpted on the thick walls of the building and almost invisible to the viewers underneath. The staircase allowed him to walk the perimeter of the dome and to come face to face with stunning mosaics of the first zone, which were not covered. His close encounter with life-size figures of martyrs and saints standing in front of these monuments comes at stark contrast to a modern viewer's experience of the rotunda, which fallen, if you have ever visited Thessaloniki, we had an earthquake in 1978, and until now, there's still scaffolding and it's impossible to visit the dome. So he was luckier than us. The same close-up viewing of the mosaics of the first zone was still possible during Cousinerie and Louis-Francois-Sebastien Fauvel's visit of the monument in 1781-82. From the number of sketches Fauvel has left us, and this is an incredible number of sketches in Paris, we assume that Fauvel was also able to climb the same steep stairwell and adopt the same viewpoint as Lucas. The mosaics of the vault were still pretty much in view in 1856 when the American novelist and poet Herman Melville visited Salonika in his grand tour of the Near East. From that visit, he carried not only fond memories of the city, but he managed to carry also some fallen tessere from Rotunda's mosaic decoration. Back to 1707, Lucas referenced to several subterranean structures whose entrances at the time of his visit had become blocked with rubble and rubbish, reflects an interesting pattern in the use of religious space along Ottoman Egnatia. We are talking about a great Christian monument, formerly a Roman mausoleum, converted into a mosque, which had retained its Christian figural decoration and appears underused. Was the rotunda space used as a mosque after all, or was its conversion, as in the case of St. Sophia in Ohrid, was more of a political statement by the Ottoman authorities, devoid of religious zeal and purpose? All those accounts are particularly important for our understanding of the reception of Egnatia's ancient and medieval heritage, in particular Byzantine, in the early modern East and West. The period during which those travelers composed their work was comfortably removed from the immediate trauma of Egnatia's fall to the Ottomans. Some of the sites they traveled and they visited were in ruinous state. Others, such as Thessaloniki and Kavala, had recovered and were bestowed with new buildings commissioned by the Ottoman administration. A recurrent phenomenon is unsurprisingly the conversion of important places of Christian worship into mosques. An equally important site, not altogether expected by Western travelers, was the religious tolerance displayed by the Ottoman administration in many aspects of public life. Eager imams showed their Western visitors around. They pointed to pieces from the place's Christian and ancient past. And in the case of St. Demetrius in Thessaloniki, they even offered agiasma, holy water. From the attitude displayed by Ottoman officials and their Ottoman subjects, the picture that emerges about Egnatia's ancient and Byzantine past is fascinating. Between ignorance vis-à-vis the past and reverence towards select sites and monuments, in particular those connected to the memory of Alexander and Philip, the inhabitants of Ottoman Egnatia display an array of feelings and understanding of their heritage. What is obvious is that the past was never a foreign land, removed from people's daily practices and rituals. The silent understanding between St. Sophia's doorkeepers in Ohrid and the Christian inhabitants that the ancient church was accessible in exchange for a few coins, the appellation of former Christian monuments in Thessaloniki with their Christian rather than Islamic name, more than two centuries after their conversion, are just snapshots of a landscape where religious tolerance and coexistence were a reality. In that landscape of beautiful ruins, glorious and painful memories and fables, The ancient world and Byzantium were always within reach, inhabiting peoples, consciousness, and space, both private and public ones. The ignorant Turk, even, that Paul Lucas encountered in drama, lived, after all, in a Byzantine tower, whose value he was not prepared to share with his literate stranger. As for the stranger, indeed the strangers we talked about this evening, their travels and accounts paved the way in the 19th century for Esprit Cuisinerie, Léon Heuzet, and Edward Lear. And here I would like to end with this beautiful view of Thessaloniki from the Monastery of Latadon by Edward Lear, now in the Houghton Library. And of course, it led to the rediscovery of Egnatia's heritage in a more systematic way. In the early 20th century, the presence of the Entente Cordiale in Macedonia led to the first excavations by soldiers of the Allied armies in Thessaloniki and Amphipolis, and to the first systematic excavation at Philippi conducted by the French School of Athens. The finds, related publications, and exhibitions have since shaped and continue to shape the archaeological map of Egnatia. Thank you.